All right, so tonight we're going to paint that urn and, well, what you see there. And so I'm just going to start with the drawing. So like my process, this is actually like considered a la prima painting. It's just as direct as I possibly can get it. And what you want to try to do is, when you paint like this, is you want to try to have your, now I know this is going to look, be a little strange, but, and I'll try to, so you guys can actually, what I try to do is, when you work from life, you want to try to have your reference or your still life on the same line as your canvas. Right, so everything that's here, you don't want to have to look down or move over, because that's gonna slow you down. You actually have more drawing errors that way. So your eyes are just doing, like, you know, that tacky cat phone where the eyes go back and forth like that. That's kind of what you're doing here, right? So this way you're not moving your head. You're staying in one position. Now, what I do, show you what I do. I put a little bit of oil on the surface first. This canvas is a cheap Michael's canvas.
That's so the paint flows?
Yes. And if I make a mistake, I'm just giving a little sheen, not a lot. You don't want to make it drippy, just to give you a film over the surface. Okay. Now, this was toned with raw umber, and just to get it, so it's, you know, you're not dealing with the white. So I already mixed some paint down here for the background. I mixed basically this color and some of the shadow color. So I'm just going to use some of the middle tone, and I'm going to start the drawing. So I'll try to move over as far as I can. Now, sometimes instead of trying to draw the things themselves, like, don't try to get into the every contour of the shape. Just try to get the big shape first, because you want to work out your composition. And if this isn't working, I can just take my paper towel and wipe it off. So let's see right here. I want to give the pear a little air. Now notice I'm just making a triangle for the pear, right? I'm not really making the pear yet, because again, if I made a mistake or it's not where it's supposed to be, if the placement's off, I can easily erase it out. Okay? Like so. Okay, so there it goes. Let's see, so from here, about there. Now you'll see me use my brush to figure out the proportion, the distance between these two. I also teach at the Atelier too, so I'm always telling the students, you know, you have to, art is, you know, painting is relative. You're relating one shape to the next. So now once we have this shape looks pretty good, I'm gonna start to work on the ellipse. Now you're gonna see something completely different, because I'm standing over the painting. You guys are sitting down. I have a bird's eye view and you guys have worm's eye view. There's no reflection on you guys, it's just what it is, okay? I'm sure you're really nice upstanding people.
Need more light, though?
No, I'm good. I have plenty of light. Thank you. Now, the idea is, like, you want to try to draw as much with the brush as possible. Now, once I have the basic shapes and the contours, now it looks like the lip comes out just a little bit more. This is all in shadow. We have inside, which is nice and dark. It also fix a lot of the drawing issues when we paint. So what I want to do now is I want to start massing in the shadow shapes. Now there's a little chip right in here, so I want to try to get that as part of the character. Here, the angles down, following the arc of the light. And this is where I could probably switch to something a little bit of brush. I'm using synthetic brushes. I do have bristle brushes too. I find that the bristle brushes, they load more paint on and you can get like more better coverage. And because I have to paint this quick, I want to make sure that I'm covering as much as possible. Now, if you guys can see, there's a coarse shadow that runs along here. So we're just going to mask that all in. Also, while I'm in this mode, I'm going to actually paint in the cast shadow. Now the colors, you're probably wondering what colors I'm using. I'm using burnt umber, burnt sienna. And there was a mixture where if you can see, well, I can't really lift it up, but it's actually that color there that I pre-mixed. That has a little red, orange, white, burnt sienna, and burnt umber together. Now, pear has the pear shape. And now it has a little cast shadow. Now, I'm going to hold off on painting the flowers because I'm going to mask in the background. The reason for that is when you're working with still life or landscape, you always want to work back to front, especially if you're working a la prima, you know, all in one sitting. So that's what I'm going to do now. And I'm going to take that paint that I had there. Probably a little too much. Now, that's actually a little warmer, so I'm going to add a little bit of the complementary color, which is blue. And what kind of blue is it? It's ultramarine blue. Now, you guys see from my point of view, The reason why I put that baffle over it was because I wanted that background to be dark. And there's really no way that you can, even with the baffles on this light, you still can't get the background, like you have to create a shadow box. And all this is just like three pieces of quarter inch foam core. So you guys can make this stuff really on the cheap. I mean, if you're handy, if you like, you know, if you work in wood, you can probably build one. But you don't need to go that far. Because the thing is, you want to have your still life contained, right, in the shadow box. I don't know if any of you guys heard of an artist named David LaFell. He taught at the Art Studency. I studied with him, and you should see the elaborate setups that they had, and their paintings, what they glowed, right? They would have, everything would be black. The room had like, it was almost lit by candlelight almost. But they got these beautiful, like Rembrandt-esque type paintings. If you guys are familiar with his work, and his wife, Sherry McGraw, I think she surpassed him quite frankly. I would never say that to his face, but I think she's much better at figures and portraits.
What's her first name?
Sherry McGraw. And they live in Mexico now? Yeah. They lived in Manhattan, and then they were splitting their time up. But now he does a lot of workshops in Scottsdale. All right, so now while we're painting, right, this is the time to actually drop in some other colors too. And I'm thinking maybe adding some lighter blue in there, especially in and around here. The reason for that is because I want that orange to have a lot of impact. So even though the blue's not there, it's not in the direct light, so the shadows can get cool. So if your light source is warm, the general rule is if you have warm light, you have cool shadows. You probably heard that before, okay? So that's what I'm after right now. Now I'm just going.
So you mix an ultramarine blue with that brown?
Ultramarine blue, yep, with the burnt umber. And there are little hints of alizarin crimson in there too, to keep the brown more chromatic. You guys know chroma is the intensity of the color, while it's in the shadow. Okay, so notice I'm like kind of easing up on my, it's not as opaque now, because now I want to transition some of those half tones from the shadow into the light. So working like this is always good to start off the night with 10 cups of coffee. So you can keep moving. Now that I don't like that color, so I'm gonna add a little. Now I have some crazy colors. So I have Venetian red. Now most people use Venetian red for skin tones, but I found that it's if you want like a reddish burnt sienna that's more red than brown. Try the Venetian red. Get that a little brighter. Now I'm adding orange to that mixture, but I have to kind of calm it down too. Now, let's say you get a little too dark in an area, just take your paper towel and just lift it off. Now, usually the top plane, if the light's coming down here, you have to think in terms of planes, right? So if this is the top plane, it's gonna accept more light, as you guys know. If it's a side plane, you can almost see my hand getting a little darker, right? Lighter, darker, right? So you have to keep that in mind when you start to mass in, because you wanna have that feeling of solidity and form. Even when it comes to, you know, something as innate as the drapery. I shouldn't even say it's innate. It's not really, because it's supporting, it's like a supporting cast to like the stars of the show, flowers.
At your show, I noticed that the portraits,
yes,
the clothes the people were wearing were mm-hmm. just as good as the faces of the people.
Yeah, well, that comes from my, I'm still working as an illustrator, but we don't paint anymore. Everything is done on the computer, but you had to be pretty thorough. Or at least my style is kind of thorough. A little story about that, the girl with the turquoise dress, because everyone wants to know, oh, was she your girlfriend, right? Yeah, of course, that's inevitable, isn't it? People are gonna ask that. And actually she was, I did a lot of Harlequin book covers back in the day, and she was one of the models. And she was she was totally hungover, and which they all were, they all partied like crazy. And she was waiting for the hero to get into his tux, and he was of course, the guys were always late. And she was just bored, and you know.
The guys were always late?
The guys were always late, yeah. Because they were partying too. Or they were at the gym, they come in there like all sweat, and then they have to like look like $1 million, and they do, because they're like, they're models, so. They could look like crap coming in, but then as soon as they get all dude'd up, they look great. Well, she was waiting for him, looking bored, and we were taking, the photographer and I didn't do the photography, they had places that did reference photography for artists. And the guy's name is Michael. And I said, well, why don't you take a couple of pictures of her just sitting down, laying down on the couch. And that wasn't the couch she was on. She was wearing that dress, but it wasn't the couch was like a ratty leather couch, like a photo studio type furniture. And so we took a couple of shots and I took it home. And I had like maybe 4 pictures. And then I started doing sketches. I did a little oil sketch of it, which is kind of what I would do for illustration, get an idea sketch together. And then I painted it. I changed the, kind of gave it more of an upscale couch. And I put the roses in the background. Kind of pick up on the dress. So that's where that came from. And it was actually just sold.
Too. That's the one you sold?
Yeah.
It was a nice picture.
Did you answer the question? Did your girlfriend
get on? No, she wasn't. No, I had this thing where it's like, you know, I'm just an artist. They're going out with like, you know, hedge fund managers and stuff like that. I didn't have a chance. They went with the money. Because they knew they only had a short window to make money. More so women.
Yeah, it's true. It's like that.
It is. I mean, I hate to, you know, be sexist in that sense, but it's true. They know where, you know, they have to think of their future.
Nowadays,
we're
taking older models.
Yes.
And overweight.
Okay, so I have a medium of turpentine and I don't have linseed oil with me, but I use, every once in a while, I use sun-thickened linseed oil, which is a little thicker.
What is it called?
Sun-thickened linseed oil. It's like stand oil,
mm-hmm.
but it's not as thick. So as you can see, I have a big palette knife and I mix a lot of this paint. The idea here is like you want to be able to cover everything. You want to be able to have the background pretty much done so that, you know, and you'll still keep a little bit of that color around. So if you have to paint into it or move things around, you can. And you can change, or if you have to cut in a little bit with the same paint. All right. Well, it's practice, and it's also, I think it's my training as an illustrator, too. That's why I teach acrylic painting, too, because there were times, you know, back in the 80s and 90s when art director would call you, like, on a Friday afternoon at 4 o'clock and ask for a finished piece by Monday morning. So you couldn't paint in oil, so you had to paint fast and to get your stuff together, and the art director would, you know, what is it? Well, you would fax a sketch. I don't know if you guys remember faxes. I'm sure some of you do.
Is it much difference between the oil and the acrylic?
A lot, because acrylics dry almost as soon as you put them on the canvas. So you have to work extremely fast, and you have to also pre-mix a lot of your colors too, or else you'll just be kind of like chasing your tail. It's hard to get you know, gradients unless you pre-mix. So like when I paint the sky or gradation of a sky, I paint maybe four different values, and then I work very fast. You spray the canvas with water to keep it workable. It really is a rough medium. That's why a lot of people don't like using it. Because it's unforgiving, it dries very quickly, and the colors dry a little darker than oil is pretty constant. Oil is probably one of the only mediums that when you put your paint down, it stays exactly the way it looks like, you know, on your palette, whereas you guys have worked in watercolor, you know that watercolor dries a lot lighter than what you would, you know, like the saying is that if it looks good in the first wash, it's wrong. It's going to dry at least 20% darker. I mean lighter. Sorry. All right. So now I want all the background done so that I can just go in and start working on the forms. Now, this is where I'm going to save some of this paint and put it off to the side. Now I'm sure you guys, maybe you won't admit to it, but I definitely will admit to it. I watch YouTube videos more than I watch regular television. I don't even watch anything on regular, like network TV, nothing.
No.
But I'll watch tons of, you know, painting videos. I'll watch, you know, discussions as I'm working. I'll just listen to them. Like, Boston Museum of Fine Arts have these lectures, and you can just paint and look. If you're inclined to do that, like, as an illustrator, I was able to listen, you know, listen with one part of my brain and work on the other. You know, it was because a lot of the stuff that you're doing, you know, is rote. Like, you know how to paint the face, you know how to paint hands and stuff. So it's, you can just have like this white noise, but you actually, you know, you pick a little bit up through osmosis. And what better than to having, you know, a lecture on Caravaggio or whoever. And so this way you kind of get, you know, you work and you get a little bit of knowledge at the same time. All right, so I'm trying to mix color, that color, so I can see I need a little red. Now, instead of using red, I'm using alizarin crimson because it's more of a pink color. And there's a guy, okay, getting back to the YouTube, there's a guy, his website is, his channel is called Draw Mix Paint. I don't know if you guys ever, his name is Mark Carter, and he actually did the official portrait of, I think, George Bush Jr. And he's a artist from, I think, Austin, Texas. Really good artist.
What's his last name?
Mark Carter, like C-A-R-D-E-R. And he's all about looking at the values. And he teaches us, I teach my students the same thing. It's like you have to really see the values first, you know, because without knowing the values, I'm taking time mixing, right? I'm not just jumping in with a color that could be wrong. I'm trying to get the color to be almost direct so that when I start to put the paint down, it's going to be that color, that value, and I'm even probably going to mix this too. So we'll see both the shadow side and then the light side, and hopefully I'll have enough for both. I'm using, to get the, now I don't use black, it's okay if you guys do, or Payne's gray. How I get my blacks, I use burnt umber and ultramarine blue. And I get a color that's, it looks something like, clean that off, something like that, okay? Now you can see that shadow is a lot warmer because it's reflective light. So I'm gonna add more burnt umber and a little bit of burnt sienna. So at the end of the night, if you guys want to take pictures with your cell phones of the setup, you're more than welcome to. This way you can, you know, take a shot of it too. So what I'm doing is, it's hard for you guys to see, but for me, I'm putting it almost directly, and the palette knife has to be in the same direction to pick up the light. So right now, that's the right value, but not the right color. So I need to get it a little more warm, so I'm going to add a little of that Venetian red. The idea is to put it in very small increments, because that Venetian red is really, it's like those phthalo colors, right? They're invasive. All right, so let's get painting now. Now I'm moving to a filbert brush because now it's like we're kind of drawing to a little bit. So if you guys have any questions, just shout them out. as I paint. Because I'm going to start really focusing in, so if you guys want to... any questions on whatever medium I'm using, or the colors on the palette, which you probably can't tell what's what. As far as my brushes, I have brushes that are, I have brushes from Michaels, and I have brushes, Da Vinci brushes, that are really expensive. I'm not brand loyal. I feel the philosophy is, you know, people ask me what's the best brush to use, and I always say, you hear other artists say, this is nothing original. It's the one that behaves. Right? Really. So it could be a brush from Michaels that just happens to have a good point, and it works. All right. I want to get the rim and work my way down.
Do you paint with palette knife or just brushes?
Just brushes. Unless I'm doing, the only time I'll use a palette knife is in landscape. When I'm trying to get, like, maybe I need to, like, get branches and texture, that's when I'll use them. Sometimes you see like a little effect and you can't help yourself, you just gotta get it in there. I tell my students, like, when they're working on something and they get bored, and we all do, it's like we're working on something in a painting that's just not coming out right, we're getting frustrated, you know, walk away, don't try to beat a dead horse, because you're just going to make the painting look overworked.
The classes that you're teaching, are they Alabama, or is it a still life that they work on?
Well, a lot of them, yeah, they do still lives from life, and now that, well, we have every Friday night now, we have our open figure class, and we're going to be starting figure classes. Actually, the open figure night is just, it's not a class, it's just an open figure. So you guys can go there, it's like $20 for 3 hours. And usually, you know, we're getting the models back, and that's always a good thing. And we're gonna start our portrait classes back again, because we had to stop with COVID. One of the models, she was like 20 something, she got it, and then this was before anyone was vaccinated, so we all had to run to CVS and get tested, and it was a mess, and since it's a not-for-profit, the board was like, you know, we gotta stop this, and this is when everyone came back, and even like in June, in early June, they still didn't want the models back in. So, it is what it is. Because I really enjoy teaching the portrait class.
So on a Friday night, is there a large group there?
There's no teacher, it's just open. You just go and draw.
Open studio night?
Yeah. And sometimes I'm, you know, on there, and of course I can't help myself if I see somebody who's drawing a leg that looks like, you know, an Edsel, then I jump in and I help them.
So if we go,
I know you guys know what Edsels are, right?
Yeah.
They're all part.
If we go and we see you, we can sit behind you and watch.
You could. Just don't make any noise. Can you, oh, you could, oh, I do everything. I'll do watercolor. I pretty much anything that I can do, because we do have longer, longer poses at the end. I think we have like 2 20-minute poses, which are great. So you can do, which is the same pose actually. So we do two of the same. So it's 40 minutes of the same pose, a longer pose. We're trying to get it so that we can get, because there are a lot of people who want to just go in and paint the figure. But again, the board's like, and then, you know, then you don't have the amount of people coming in, and if it doesn't, everything is like, you know, cost driven. And if you don't have the money, they'll just cancel something. We tried that one Sunday, and it wasn't a big turnout. But there were a few people that really, either you have people who really love to do it, and then you have people that might take it for a little while. I don't know if they just get self-conscious, because we actually had, there was another artist, one of my friends, William Lowe, he's another illustrator, top-notch guy, you know, we would do these studies, and I don't know if it was a good thing to be doing that amongst people, because I think it intimidates them sometimes. So that's why we kind of backed off on that. But they were kind of upset that we had to stop the class. And this was before COVID. All right, so I'm still working on massing in the lights. There's a nice core shadow that's running right. Can you guys see that? Sorry. Right along here. Now I see a lot of like orangey color being bounced back into that shadow. Because you want to relate shadows, so now it feels like it's together. Also, you'll notice too that the shadows up here are a little cooler. And that's because, well, these lights that are on the cool side, so we have to cool down those shadows there.
I thought it was just the opposite. It was like the warm light and cool shadows.
Yes, but this is reflective light, so this is actually light bouncing back into the shadow. this is a trick that I learned in school. Mm-hmm. You do like a zigzag, mm-hmm. and then you run it down. You guys have seen this before. Sure.
Does it soften the edge?
Yep. And it kind of gives you like that little extra turn. And it definitely gets soft. And you could use it on edges. You could use it, especially edges in the shadows, when you're painting drapery. It's excellent for that. And you probably don't see my eyes, but I'm squinting a lot.
Why?
Why
are you squinting?
Well, when you open your eyes wide, you see too much information, but when you squint, you start to just see the bigger shapes. So it's always good especially when you're starting a painting and you're blocking things in, is squint. And you'll see that the background, you see the value of the background, you won't see the little details. But you'll see the breakdown of the lights and the darks. And like I can see now that I have to probably cool that down a little bit and make that a little bit darker as I proceed. So by looking at things that way, you can see the values a lot better. All right, so always squint when you can. And I know people are like, like a lot of my students say, oh, but I don't want any more wrinkles around my eyes. Like, yeah, you get better paintings.
You really get the wrinkles anyway.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, when you get
to
not smile, so you're
I know, exactly. So, that's what I say. Well, you smile, don't you? Mm-hmm. Oh, that's a wrinkle. Sometimes it's one of the best brushes in your arsenal. You need to just put the lights in there. All right. So what I'm doing now is I'm just lightening this up just a little bit. This is not the highlight, but I'm working my way to the highlight. Now I don't know, some of you might work a different way, but I've gotten to a bad habit in art school where instead of having, like, you'll see some artists come in and they'll have like 10 brushes in one hand. I never did that because they'd have like, one would have the medium value if they're doing something monochromatic or or a landscape, and they'll have three or four different shades of green. I've always been the type of artist that just works with one brush at a time. The downside to that is you wear out your brushes that much faster because you're constantly cleaning them. You're cleaning them more than you would if you had two brushes. So you probably, I don't know if you guys are wondering why I'm using the same, I mean, I'm varying the sizes of the brushes, but for the most part, I'm using one at a time. All right, so let's get it from accents in here. Accents. You guys know what accents, you know what accents are. They're like the darkest part of the shadow. They're not the shadow, but they're like where two forms meet. It gets darker than a shadow. Now what's happening here in the shadows, we have actually multiple light sources, which happens. It happens in my studio at the Atelier all the time, where you're gonna have one light, it's like right here, I'm seeing a light source here, it's actually being filled by these lights, which is okay, but try to make it so that you discern one main shadow. Now I'm gonna get this a little bit more turning. Sometimes you'll see inside, you'll see, well, I see three, especially in the, when the students are doing cast drawings at night, they'll see like three, because we have like a bank light and then we have incandescent lights in the middle, and they'll get confused. So what I do is I have them do their setup away from the lights in the room, so like their back is towards the wall and their setup like this is against the light, so you don't want to have that light interfering, or I should say, you don't want to have five or six different light sources because it could get very confusing. Start working on the hand. I'm sure you've all been waiting for this. The big moment. The hand.
The colors.
This is worth the price of admission. Now this is something where I should actually, even though it's not that big, I still want to mix the colors. And you guys know, like when you're painting something, you know, especially fruit, I mean, this happens to be fake fruit, but you're gonna have so many different colors. Like if, let's say I was working on this at home and I really wanted to do something a little bit more time-honored, I would look at all those values and I would, not that I would mix every one, I would try to get like one big average like I just did here. So I have like, I don't know if you guys can see that, but I have a pretty big amount, and it's only for that little pair. But like that's what I can do is I can start adding darker, like a darker green. I could use, and the shadows probably would be more towards a brown tone than they would a green tone. I should say in color. And so when you're working, you always want to make more of the average color, okay? So like when I do portraits, actually with that, this was probably earmarked, this canvas was probably earmarked for a portrait because it's actually the same tone as, well, Caucasian skin, right? So I try to do that so when I mask out the head, I already have an average there. So all I have to do is concentrate on the shadows and the half tones. And then when I mask in the flesh, the flesh tone in the light, if it's three quarters simply means that a quarter is in shadow and the other three quarters are in the light. So so that's, you want to mix as much paint as possible because you're going to be painting into that average. That's how Sargent worked. That's why his paintings look so lush, was because he knew exactly where to place that paint. And break up where the half tones, and it didn't really do too much as far as, well, he didn't really blend all that much. Maybe on some women he did, and that's probably because they asked him to. And I think that's probably why at the end of his career, he didn't want to do portraits any longer. Because even, you know, even for Johnson or Sargent, there's always going to be a patron or a sitter that's going to say, I don't like the way you painted my mouth. You're going to have to change it. Mm-hmm. It's probably some duchess saying that. So you had to acquiesce.
Have
you
done any famous people?
Yeah, I've done
should.
A lot of people, you know, portraiture isn't what it used to be. I know down south there's still a respect for it, and even there it's not as, because I used to go to those workshops at the Met, and there were some great portrait painters, and they were all from the south, but even they said that, you know, it's tough. I mean, there's so many good people that are doing it. It's hard to break in. But that's why I didn't really pursue it. And you know, working as an illustrator, you know, you always have a paycheck at the end. Like if you weren't commissioned, well, you know, if you just an easel painter. Adjust, but if you were an easel painter, you would have, you know, you'd have to hope that painting sold. I mean, I still take on commissions, but again, nobody doing this. I actually just got a commission from this lady in Huntington who saw my work in St. James, and she wants double portrait of her children, which is kind of cool. And there's actually one portrait commission, but it really wasn't, it's funny because it wasn't, when the guy came to me, he said, oh, I have a street scene for you to paint. And I priced it, and he's all, I on my trip to Spain, to Cadiz, I have a picture of, I have a street scene. So I gave him the price, which was, wrong thing to do. Look at the photo reference before you commit to a price. It turned out to be four children. And I thought I was going to be painting like doorways and old, you know, like old buildings and stuff. So I'm like, uh-oh. And
is that the one in Cadiz?
Yeah, the children.
That was beautiful.
Yeah.
What a great amazing.
And luckily, I kept it. Although, not luckily, but that size, that scale, When I, again, because of my training as an illustrator, I was able to, I mean, those, the faces, if you ever get a chance to go, they're about as big as my thumbnail, the whole head of these kids. And they have attitude, too. That's why, and the thing is, when he gave me the photograph, he sends me this picture, and it's a picture of this guy, like, you see, like, this part of his jacket and his sleeve. And I'm like, where are the kids? And then he says, you have to blow it up. So that wasn't the picture. He did that so that he didn't disturb the children, and he was able to get the attitude that he wanted. And I'm like, so that you can imagine what that picture looked like. So I had to do a lot of improv on that.
The clothes in that were amazing. The jeans on the girl.
Yeah.
And one of the kids was wearing sneakers.
Yeah.
I mean, you did a great job on that.
Thank you. Thank you.
That's the hardest part.
Oh, yeah.
Is the habitat, meaning
the
clothes.
Yeah, and a lot of the, like, the background and the street, like that, you know, that worn down cobblestone, mm-hmm. that was all a lot of glazing and scumbling mm-hmm. and stuff like that. Mm-hmm.
How large was the painting?
11 by 14.
Oh, yeah.
It's tiny. And good thing I... Because that was what I—that's what I quoted him on. Good thing I didn't say, like, you know, 24 by 30 or something. Right. For that price. But now I learned—you learned your lesson.
Right.
But when someone says street scene, you think, oh, a couple
buildings.
Of buildings, a doorway or something, a cat in the doorway.
Hanging baskets.
But yeah, I painted myself into a corner. But he's a nice guy, and, you know. He wants to do some more paintings. So it's always good, like when you have somebody who's, you know, who wants to collect your work. It's always a good thing. So okay, getting back to painting, I'm trying to get a little bit more warmth, just really massing in the shadow colors. I'm warming them up a little bit, and now I'm going to start working my way out and into the light. So these are the half tones. So this is what makes things look nice and round, that you want to like grab them. So this is the working out from the shadow. And this is where you look at where you're, like right from where I'm looking is a plane that comes down, a side plane. I'm just going to go directly to the complementary, which is green, because green's a secondary. I'm going to an orange. Start working some color. Again, those orange tones will kind of like help blend.
You just wipe the paint off.
Mm-hmm. Don't feel that you have to live with a mistake. Because it will come back to haunt you. So when you see something that's wrong, try to rectify it. Thank you. Now I am using a little, I don't have any sap green, so I'm using, believe it or not, viridian green, but I'm using a lot of burnt sienna and that Venetian red to tone it down. Because as you guys know, that viridian green is very volatile,
yes.
Very cold. It's actually a great color for flesh tone, believe it or not. Like if you've seen any paintings by Joshua Reynolds, you know, the little English children, they have that alabaster skin, and they look almost like they're void of color, but the only color you see is like rose madder and viridian green, but done in a very good way. Now there is a little highlight right down the middle, and whenever you're painting something with green, don't just use white as your highlight color. Always add yellow. Even if it's a red apple, never use pure white. Always add that yellow, because if you don't, you're going to have these chalky highlights. So remember that. It gives them a little bit more color. Now it might look like it's cool, but I want my highlight to be nice and warm. Paint the shadow. Which here's, again, burnt umber, ultramarine blue, and a little alizarin crimson. I just put a little turpentine on my brush. I want to lift that up because I don't want to paint into anything else. I want to have this value be dominant. Now, you guys, I have, last year during lockdown, or quarantine, our school had us do, they didn't have us do it. They didn't mandate you do a, having a YouTube channel, but I needed to get the videos to my students. And a lot of them weren't computer savvy, so they probably wouldn't know how to deal with a Dropbox or something. So what I decided to do is create a YouTube channel, so all they have to do is click the link, and they're right there. So if you go to YouTube and enter in my name, you'll see a lot of stuff like portraits. Actually, that girl over there, Cassidy, you could see me paint that. We did it was a two-step process. We did the drawing first, and then we So they did a full rendering, and then they transferred the drawing onto the canvas. Okay, so they did a full value drawing, and then we did a wash in, and then I did I taught the class how to use the Zorn flesh palette, which is only a few colors: red, yellow ochre, white, and black. That's all there is, because you know I didn't want them to run out and get, you know, well, they couldn't run out anyway, but I wanted them to use the colors that they had. So the students did pretty well. There's also some shadows in there. Which are coming from those plants, those flowers, which we'll get to. So did a lot of you guys do a lot of painting during quarantine?
I did some.
You did some? Yeah. Good. I heard that, you know, a lot of artists did a lot of work because they couldn't do anything else.
That's right. Oh, we're lucky.
Yeah. We were actually probably the busiest we ever were, my wife and I, because we teach, and my wife teaches at it's a for-profit school, and they had to get up and running immediately, and so we had to learn the Zoom program, you know. So then once I learned it, helping her out, I made a proposal. I said, well, we're going to lose some of our students if we don't get online. And so we had a Zoom meeting with the teachers. And some of them knew Photoshop a little bit. And some of them said, well, we have our cell phone cameras. And we could do basically like a quick, like if they had to do a demonstration to show the students, you know, how to do a painting or whatever, they could work that way, just like I'm working right now, and then the students would follow that. All right, so we're gonna start working on.
Was it a Zoom class?
It was a Zoom class, and because a lot of the teachers didn't know the technology, they didn't really want to do it. Because I opened up my big mouth, I got most of the students, so I was working more during lockdown than I was when we came back, because I had everyone else's students until everyone went back into the studio. Then I had my following.
How do the students like that?
Some of them loved it. Some of them, and some of them are still like this. Like in my morning, my Monday morning class, they're the holdovers who don't want to come back in because they learned that they could get more done by not schlepping all their stuff into, you know, St. James from where they live, and they could basically work in their pajamas or their underwear.
Exactly.
And they could, they could do their painting.
They could get frustrated by themselves, too.
Yeah. Okay. We most of this is contrasting against the So I'm just going to try to draw the masses here.
Bill, it's 8:30.
Okay.
Can we wrap it up in like a half hour?
Absolutely, yes, we can. Let me just get one of these little Chinese boxes in there. Alright, so in order to get that bright light, I'm going to start to take out. See? Now, this is when you're working.
You took the paint off?
I'm taking the paint off, yeah, I'm lifting it out.
Because it wouldn't cover correctly?
Yeah, because I want that, when I put that orange down,
you want really the orange.
I want it to be really orange, so this is how you guarantee. I'll do a couple, and then we'll call it a night. Basically, what I would do is, I'm using my fingernail to get some of those lines, and then they could be painted when the background is dry. You can go back in. Now, I usually, when I do stuff like that, I usually use a mall stick just to keep my hand steady. So you guys could do that too. I'll probably take a snapshot of this. There's one that's really close, which is right there. Close right there. And then we have the little ones on the ground. They have to be delineated to some degree. Now I am dipping it in, I'm dipping my paper towel into the turpentine because I want to guarantee that I lift all that paint. Not too much, but just enough. Now here we have a little something there I can pull up. So the reason why I put these things, it's just kind of like, you guys are wondering, well, why did you just have these things just sit there? Well, they're kind of, compositionally, they're bridging the shapes together a little bit, right? So that's why they're there. And again, like if I had, you know, something like this, you probably maybe 4 or 5 solid hours, you could probably get it done. Because everything will be wet. Sometimes what I'll do is I'll have the students use a little clove oil if they're using a lot of earth tone. The clove oil keeps the painting, the paint from drying. It's sort of like a retarder. And it really works well. Just use a tiny bit though. All right, we'll paint one of these. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna find mass it in with the orangey red. Alright, so I'll call out, maybe I'll do this one here. Now from my side, I see it being a little lighter. Now these are kind of complex things, you know, they're they called Japanese or Chinese boxes?
Chinese lanterns, I think.
Lanterns. Lanterns. Chinese lanterns, yeah. Yeah. They're pretty, but they are hard to paint. And so you try to just get the general shape. do is I'll just sow, you see, I'm going to add a little linseed oil, turpentine mixture, and see if I can get those little stems working. Always try to break the line up, try not to get like a perfect line. I have to usually, when I teach the watercolor class, you know, they have to be a little bit, like, hold the brush out a little further and just try to get like an erratic line looks better than an overly ruled line, and especially when you're doing things that are organic. Now I'm using straight up cadmium orange and cadmium red to get these shapes. This is where you paint. You do have to slow down a little bit to get the right contour. Negative too, just like in watercolor, paint around the form. Well, that's why you never throw away anything. Keep all your colors together. And since there's not a lot of leaves on this thing, I guess they fell off. We're gonna add a few. Now, you put a couple in one value, and then what you do is you just take another value, just run across. So you have multiple, or varying values of the green, and that will make your little leaves look more believable. Now I'm going to put some that are actually a little darker. Something that dark where you can't even see it. Well, so I'm going to come back and I'm going to touch the tops of them.
Just going to hide them.
Exactly. That's it. So this is where you kind of have to look at the whole thing and start to design, right? And if I had more time, I could articulate that a little bit better. But because these things are, they're a little sparse, they're missing things. Gay had to put one of those flowers back on. It's embarrassing. But
are they real?
No, they're real, but that's why they look like. I've never seen these things real, though. Like, I wouldn't even know.
You have to go to China. Chinese boxes.
Now, if there was a time to put paint down with impasto, it would be right now with a little palette knife. Mm-hmm. This would be the time.
Mm-hmm. I have a question. Do you
sure.
mix your oranges and things? Like, do you like mix, or do you use like two more colors? Like,
well,
do you
right
have, like,
now,
a limited palette that you, and then mix a lot of colors.
Yeah. See. Yeah. No, I'm not from that school either, where a lot of instructors would say you should really learn how to mix your greens and, you know, mix your oranges. But I'm like, well, I can probably get more intense color if I use the color itself and trying to mix it. Because if you have to mix certain types of green, you have to get certain types of blue. Like, you'd have to get like a phthalo blue and like a really strong cadmium yellow to make a viridian green. So why don't you just buy the viridian green, because it's you know, it's more direct. So that whole philosophy, that probably holds true more for watercolor people, because then they can you know, because they're mixing on the palette, they're mixing on the paper. If you guys want to know a decent oil painting brush, I've been using these mongoose brushes. You can get them at Lidl.
What's the name of them?
They're made from Monarch. They're called Monarch brushes, and they're made from mongoose hair. They're not as stiff as bristle, but they're not as soft as sable. They're kind of in the middle. They're good if you do a lot of landscape. Whenever you need that really intense highlight sitting on top of the form. Breaking my own rule that I tell the students never to do. Highlights are never pure white.
Yeah.
You guys know that,
right?
That. You should have stopped me. now, if I was going to paint this again, continue to paint it, the flowers that are way in the back, I would paint right into the wet paint. Okay, because now, just so you see the process, I would want to keep those nice and dark so that I can start building up maybe that, this flower here, which is more in the foreground, I can pull that one out and get that a little brighter. So this way you can see that these flowers that are in the recess, they're going to stay back there. And you don't want them to get too bright. You want to keep them as recessed as possible. But the cup is like one in here, which you can barely see. Well, this is my point of view. You just kind of get the general shape. And then the one flower that's in the foreground, you wipe that out a little, and that'll be a little brighter. Now that paint is steadying up a little bit, so I need to use my turpentine to pick it out. I got this a little dark because those are the stems in the shadow. See, I just scratched the line. That's one technique, too. And I have something to follow. much better when you're, not when you're aware of it. We should always try to go back and paint more from life, even when we're painting from photographs. Because what happens is, when you paint from photographs too much, you don't see as much information. And you probably hear this from a lot of artists who do these demonstrations. You just don't see the subtlety that you can see. Like, if this was a photograph, I couldn't see. Everything would get too dark. I wouldn't be able to see the lights, the atmosphere, the way it's truly, representing the nature. So.
Do you do a lot of pointing?
Yes. In fact, a lot of the paintings in that show from Maine, when I take a vacation, it's a painting vacation. I just paint. So, or during lockdown, I was just kind of driving around, did a lot of paintings in the harbor, some boats, directly from the setting up because I wanted to be outside. What am I doing?
Yeah, I was just gonna ask you.
Well, because it's too light and you don't want the eye to run off. In fact, I would go so far as to make that cast shadow a little wider. See, by having that too light, your eye just goes right up. So you have to frame, even if it's not in the painting, you have to do things to the picture. That's why it's like, whenever you look for, I don't know if it happens to you guys, but whenever you look for, and you ever look for a picture and say, I want the perfect picture to paint from, or I should say a photo to paint from, you'll never find it. Because you're always seeing artwork done. And it's like, well, all that stuff was, all the composition was worked out. Photographer is limited to, the law of thirds or whatever, but an artist can do a lot more to an image than a photographer can. So that's why you never find the perfect image to paint, because they don't exist until you paint. Until you paint them, then you can make them your own in a sense. Do things to them to really. Now what I would do with this one, I would paint more of the flowers, obviously, to finish it. So I, and I might even go back when it dries and I may glaze some of the background a little darker. I wouldn't touch anything. Glazing isn't, like when people say, well, I glazed this down, or I'm gonna glaze my painting, it doesn't mean that you're repainting anything. You just change it. You're either changing the local color, usually to, it could be a shadow, it could be a half tone, it could be in the light area, or you're just adding depth to the shadow or adding depth to a half tone. So by using the glazing, you could make the picture look a little richer. You can create contrasts that don't exist in the picture, but you're bolstering up a contrast that you really want that you didn't get during the initial paintings. So that's what you can do after the fact. And people say, well, when is a good time to glaze a painting? And there's some people that say you have to wait 6 months. I'm like, as long as the paint's dry, you're good to go.
See, that's the light.
Oh, that's it.
I'm
over. Last call. Last call for a Chinese lantern.
He's leaving, Kevin.
All right, let's go.
Is he leaving?
Okay, well, there it is, guys.
Thank you so much.
So if you guys want to run up here and take a picture, because I'm going to take a picture right now of this thing, and you guys can, you know, if you wanted to paint it.
On your way home, when you get home?
On your way home.
You're going to use the photograph now to finish it.
Yeah. So I'll take everything down. I probably didn't reproduce this.